Praise God. So, in our reading from the Bible, because we are doing a parallel reading of the Bible through the whole Bible, we're in 1 Kings chapter 11. And so let's go to 1 Kings chapter 11. And of course, whenever you talk about 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 King, 1 and 2 Chronicles, you're talking about the kings of Israel. Okay? Let me just remind you that God never intended for Israel to have kings, because God was their king. And when God is your king, you don't need another king. Praise God. The reason why we have so much upheaval in the world today is because people are opting for other kings or king-like figures and have not allowed God to be the rightful ruler in their life. Praise God. And so, if you're at 1 Kings chapter 11, you know that your subtopic is talking about Solomon. All right? So here's the deal. The first three kings of Israel, we said this in the past, it bears repeating. The first three kings of Israel represented the United Kingdom. That means that all 12 tribes of Israel were together. They were united under the first three kings of Israel. The first king is Saul. He had no heart for God. The second king is David. He had a whole heart for God. And Solomon is the third king, and he had half heart for God. And we're going to learn why he was half-hearted after we read 1 Kings chapter 11. All right, because Solomon has a woman problem, and he gets it honestly. His father, David, had that problem, but he takes it to a whole different level, okay? And so, starting at verse 1, 1 Kings chapter 11, it says, "Now King Solomon defiantly loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women." Now, first of all, we can stop right there. First of all, these people weren't even supposed to be around, because when God brought them to the promised land, they were supposed to destroy the inhabitants of the promised land. So that we have all of these ites means that they were disobedient to what God told them to do. And because of that, these people are going to be thorns in the side of Solomon. Now, it was customary back in that time that when kings conquered a people, one of the ways they signed treaties was they would take a woman from that country and put them in their harem. And so it was like they married the queen or a woman of that area. And so this is what is happening. And so get this. Solomon is married to a bunch of women. Okay? So from the very nations, verse 2, of whom the Lord said to the Israelites, "You shall not associate with them, nor shall they associate with you, for the result will be that they will turn away your hearts to follow their gods." Yet Solomon clung to these in love. So what is Solomon doing according to verse 2? He is loving these women. The women got idol gods, and they're going to turn Solomon's heart toward their gods. One of the Ten Commandments was, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." And so here is a king of Israel, the third king of the United Kingdom, and he is allowing women to turn his heart from Almighty God to idol gods. Verse 3, he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned his heart away from God. You all see that? Let me read verse 3 again. He had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines. And his wives turned his heart away from God. And let's talk about Solomon for a minute, because here's what Solomon was given when he first took the throne. God came to Solomon, and God said, "What would you desire of me?" And Solomon said, "I need wisdom in how to lead your people." You know what God told him? God said, "Since you didn't ask to be rich, and since you didn't ask, you know, for popularity or fame, I'm going to give you wisdom, and I'm going to give you the rest of it too." So you know what Solomon encountered? The best that life could offer. Whenever you think of any subject, Solomon had the best of it. Okay? He obviously had the best women, because he had 1,000 of them from a whole bunch of different people and tribes and nations. You know, they had the prettiest women in their harems, and so he had the best of women. And if you count 1,000 women, 1,000, they're only 365 days in a year. So this guy had so many women, he had a woman for every night for over 2 years. And he could go into one and not see her for a whole nother year. And when you read Songs of Solomon, you get that the idea of the kind of love that he had for women. Here's the other thing. He had so nice a life until he wrote the book of Ecclesiastes. The book of Ecclesiastes, the message of Ecclesiastes is this. When you've had everything that life can offer you, when you've had the finest, and Solomon, whatever whiskey or wine or strong drink there was, he had it. If they had weed back in that day, whatever you could smoke, he had the best of that. He had the best of everything. And he ends up saying, "Empty, empty, everything is empty without God." I'm going to repeat this because this is very, very important. And in your Bible, it may say vanity of vanities, all is vanity. What he was saying was, you can live life and to the fullest and get everything that you think you want, but if you don't have the Lord, your life is empty and meaningless. This from the man who had everything. And so Solomon started out with God on it in his favor. And yet, this Solomon, with all of the wisdom that God gave him, allowed 1,000 women to turn his heart away from God. Now, you can replace anything in that verse, because anything that takes your heart away from God, that's a problem. So whatever it is, if it's money, wealth, position, popularity, whatever it is, sports, nothing should come between you and God. Because God is the best thing that anybody could have. If God be for you, he's greater than the world against you. Right? Yeah.
About two things, Pastor. The first one has to do with the fact, because when I read this, it bothers me because I think about the fact that God did give him wisdom. And so he knew it was wrong. He clearly knew it was wrong, but he still chose to do, you know, to be with these women or, you know, to take that, took him away from God, mm-hmm. his relationship with God. And then the second thing is, it's almost kind of reminds me in your devotional today that during that time frame of his life, he was lukewarm.
Mm.
Because, I mean, in the sense that
yep.
you know, he had everything
yep.
he could possibly want.
Yep.
But doing nothing for the Lord.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know, but I'm just the thought.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. He's lukewarm because he's half-hearted. You know, instead of him being on fire for God, he's half-hearted. He allows things, in this his instance, people, to turn his heart away from God. And nothing should be that big in our life. Now, let's say this. There have been times in our lives when we knew things were wrong, but we did them anyway. So we can talk about Solomon, but we have to look at ourselves as well, right? And then some people have said to me, you know, that the Bible says, and I want to correct this tonight, that the Bible says that God will not put any more on you than you can bear. I've heard people say that. That is not in the Bible. That is not true. Okay, the Bible says that there is no temptation that is greater than man, or that man is not seen, that God with the temptation will give you a way of escape, that you can bear it. Okay? But life is going to teach you that there are situations in our lives that we cannot bear without God. And if you don't believe that, all you got to do is get a bad report from the doctor. And without God, a bad report will sink you. Think you got some money in the bank and all your money is gone and you don't have any way of paying your bills, you don't have any way of paying your medical bills, anything. That's a dilemma. We need God. Amen. You know, because if we don't have God, there's no way we can make it. We live, move, and have our being in the Lord.
Amen.
And so nothing. I want everybody to say nothing.
Nothing.
Do not let anything turn your heart away from God. Because it ain't that important. You know, the songwriter said, I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I would rather have Jesus than riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus. Give me everything. You can have everything, but give me Jesus. Because when you have Jesus, guess what? You got everything. Now, he says in verse 3, after we learn that he's got 700 wives and 300 concubines, and his wives turned his heart away from God, verse 4 says, for when Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away after other gods, and his heart was not completely devoted to the Lord his God, as was the heart of his father David. So you see, there is a division between David and Solomon. So again, I told you that David had a whole heart for God. Solomon's heart was not like his father's. Because one of the things that we learned about David was that even though David got wrong sometimes, he ran back to God. He always turned back to God. And when he sinned, he said, God, I'm sorry. You need to clean me up, purge me, wash me, restore in me a right spirit. That was not how Solomon dealt with things. And so his heart was not like his father's heart. Verse 5, for Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the fertility goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the horror, detestable idol of the Ammonites. Solomon did evil things in the sight of the Lord and did not follow the Lord fully as his father David had done. Then Solomon built a high place for worshiping Chemosh, the horror, detestable idol of Moab, on the hill which is east of Jerusalem, and for Moloch, the horror, detestable idol of the sons of Ammon. Verse 8, and he did the same for all of his foreign wives who burned incense and sacrificed to their gods. And so you got idols all over Israel. And the king is the one who's erecting them. It's no secret then why Israel is going to rebel against God, and God is going to have to allow persecution to come upon the Israelites. Because as I tell us continually, if you don't do your duty, the Lord will whoop that booty. And that's a fact. Because God disciplines whom he loves. If you do what is right, you get a few stripes. But if you don't do what is right, you get many. And certainly Solomon, he allowed these things to happen. And these foreign gods, you know how bad Israel got? In order to gain favor of these idols, they even sacrificed their own babies. That's how bad they got. And when that happened, God turned his back on the nation. And in the northern kingdom, later on, the Assyrians are going to come and almost destroy them. In 721 BC and 586 BC, Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians are going to conquer the southern kingdom and take them into Babylonian captivity for 70 years. And some of our major prophets do their ministries in a foreign country, in Babylon, in Persia, because of disobedience. Okay? Verse 9, so the Lord became angry with Solomon because his heart was turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice. Now listen, it's a bad thing to make God mad. Have you ever made somebody mad? You know, I know when we used to go to, when I was growing up at school, you know, if you made somebody mad, it might be a fight that ensues after school. And they tell you, say, you meet me, you know, on the playground after school, we're going to settle this. And sometimes folk would be trying to find a way to get out early, you know, so they didn't have to meet, you know, the mob, because it's going to be a mob. And folk would be, you know, edging you on. They wasn't even in the fight. They just want to see a fight. Right? That's why back when I was growing up, fights didn't last long. Because if you lost a tooth and somebody lost an eye, it ain't going to last long. And here's the thing. Ain't nobody a winner. Because one couldn't see and the other couldn't eat. See? So it didn't last a long time. Right? But angry. You know, when people get angry at one another, they fight, or they, you know, they cause sometimes great harm. But you don't want to make God angry at you. Because whereas people, they can destroy your body, they can't send you to hell. And they can't allow you to come into heaven, but God can. And God can hurt you without even putting a finger on you. All God got to do is back up from you and leave you to yourself. And you will self-destruct. Right? Let me tell you if you need to read the book of Job. And we've talked about Job, haven't we? Recently. And all God did was give Satan permission to test Job. But instead of testing it, the devil tempted him and messed with his family, messed with his possessions, even messed with his health. And Job held on to his faith. And because of that, God blessed him bountifully at the end of the book of Job. So you don't want to get God angry. Because no, he ain't the one. Okay. Verse 10, and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not follow other gods, but he did not observe, remember, or obey what the Lord had commanded. So God is telling him, you know, what he should do, and he's saying, no, I ain't going to do that. That's a bad place to be, right? You know, so, you know, we come to worship. We hear the word of God. We ought to be reading the word of God every day at home, getting some word. We ought to be praying. We ought to have meditation, you know. And even with all of that, sometimes we misstep. But you don't want to stay out there long. Because you'll be like that prodigal son in the 15th chapter of Luke. You stay out there too long, you'll find yourself in a pig pen, wanting to eat what the hogs eat. And I don't know if you know anything about hogs, but if you've ever grown up in the South or been in the South, you never have to ask people where the pig pen was. Your nose would tell you, right? And hogs would eat anything, right? They used to take the slop to the hogs. Matter of fact, they call it slopping the hog. This Jewish boy wanted to eat what hogs was eating. He had, you know, fallen that far. And he said, I'm going to go home and I'm going to tell daddy just to make me a hired servant. Because even the hired servants are living better than I'm living. That's what life will do to you when you try to live it without God. You'll find yourself in the pig pen of life. And there are a whole bunch of people who are wallowing in pig pens today, even as I speak. Because instead of them going to the Lord, they're going to other things, trying to satisfy the hunger that's inside of them. But like Solomon, they find out that it's empty without God. But if you ever taste and see that the Lord is good, you won't want to turn to anything else. Praise God. You want to keep him in your life because Jesus is the best thing that's ever happened to me. So therefore, verse 11, the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this and have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will certainly tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. So the Lord is going to take his kingdom. Now, in 1 Kings chapter 10, when the Queen of Sheba came to see the kingdom, she had heard about it. You know, folks, you know, if you have nice things or whatever and somebody know about it, they're going to tell somebody else, right? Here's all you got to do. Buy a nice car and drive it down the street. You ain't got to broadcast. You ain't got to tell nobody. If somebody see you in a nice car, they're going to say, man, you see what so-and-so driving? That looked pretty good, right? Word gets out when you have nice things. So when the Queen of Sheba came to Israel and she looked at all of what God had blessed Solomon with, she said, the half has not been told. You know, they've been talking about it, but it ain't even like they said. You know, this kingdom is immaculate. It is fantastic. But now in chapter 11, God says, I'm going to tear it away from you because you didn't know how to handle it. It's bad for God to bless you with a major blessing and you blow it because God gives and God taketh away. I don't think y'all heard me, so I'm going to repeat this. God giveth and God can take away. And you've seen people who had great gifts, great, you know, blessings and lose it. And it's not a pretty picture when you lose major blessings that God has given you. Right? And so God is going to tear away the kingdom from Solomon. Here's what I want you to do. I have to inject this. Because you remember God, David wanted to build God a house. Remember that? Right. And God said, you can't build my house, but because you had it in your heart to build my house, I'm going to build your house. So here God does not say I'm going to destroy the kingdom, because to destroy the kingdom would be to destroy the Davidic line, and David's house would not go forward. So he's not going to destroy the Davidic kingdom. He's just going to separate it so that Solomon will not have the kingdom, and the kingdom is going to divide under the next king because of Solomon's sins. So whereas the kingdom is united with 12 tribes, it's going to be divided. 10 tribes are going to go to the north, and only a 1.5 tribe will stay in the south. And in the south is the Davidic kingdom in Jerusalem. In the north, 10 tribes represent the northern kingdom, or Samaria, or Ephraim, or Israel. and they're going to set up idol gods and not even come to the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Weeks, Feast of Tabernacles. They're not going to do that. And this is one of the reasons why when Jesus met that woman at the well, she said to him, "We worship in the mountains." Who were these mountain worshipers? They were the northern kingdom, those 10 tribes that had gone to the north. She said, "And you all worship in the temple." That was a southern tribe. Well, they all were supposed to be together. But right here we find out that God allowed separation to take place because of the sins of Solomon. Okay? Verse 11 again. "Therefore the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this and have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will certainly tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. However, I will not do it in your lifetime for the sake of your father David, but I will tear it out of the hand of your son Rehoboam. However, I will not tear away all the kingdom. I will give one tribe, Judah, to your son for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen." Y'all see that? Very important. So it wasn't an accident that the tribe split. It was God's hand that made that happen. God raises up adversaries, and that starts in verse 14. "Then the Lord stirred up an adversary against Solomon, Hadad, the Edomite. He was of royal descent in Edom. For it came about when David was in Edom and Joab, the commander of the army, had gone up to bury those killed in battle and had struck down every male in Edom. For Joab and all the army of Israel stayed there 6 months until he had killed every male in Edom. That Hadad escaped to Egypt, he and some Edomites from his father's servants with him, while Hadad was still a little boy. They set out from Midian, south of Edom, and came to Paran, and took men with them from Paran and came to Egypt, to Pharaoh, king of Egypt, who gave young Hadad a house and ordered food and provisions for him and gave him land. Hadad," verse 19, "found great favor with Pharaoh, so that he gave Hadad in marriage the sister of his own wife, the sister of Tapenes, the queen." So here, look at what's happening. Where did Israel come out of captivity?
Egypt.
So here, he's letting one of his enemies, Hadad, an Edomite, go to Egypt, and Egypt is feeding this dude and giving him houses and land so that he can grow strong. Why? To come and whoop Israel. God will turn your enemies against you when you turn your back on God. And it's not going to be pretty. The sister of Tapenes, verse 20, gave birth to Genubath, Hadad's son, whom Tapenes weaned in Pharaoh's house. And Genubath was in Pharaoh's household among the sons of Pharaoh. Verse 21, but when Hadad heard in Egypt that David had died and that Joab, the commander of the army, was dead, Hadad said to Pharaoh, "Let me leave so that I may go to my own country." Then Pharaoh said to him, "But what have you lacked with me that now you ask to go to your own country?" He replied, "Nothing. Nevertheless, you must let me go." Why does he need to let him go? Because God is controlling this situation. And God will give your enemies, they don't even know what they're doing, but they will rise up and come to whip you when you turn your back on God. Verse 23, God also stirred up another adversary for Solomon, Rezin, the son of Eliada, who had fled from his master Hadadezer, king of Zobah. Rezin gathered men to himself and became leader of a marauding band after David killed those in Zobah. They went to Damascus and stayed there, and they reigned in Damascus. So Rezin was an adversary to Israel all the days of Solomon, along with the evil that Hadad inflicted. Rezin hated Israel and reigned over Syria. Jeroboam, verse 26, Solomon's servant, the son of Nebat, an Ephrathite of Zereda, whose mother's name was Zeruah, a widow, also rebelled against the king. Now this, so he got internal problems and external problems. Now this is the reason why he rebelled against the king. Solomon built the Milo fortification, and he repaired and clothed the breach of the city of his father David. The man Jeroboam was a brave warrior, and when Solomon saw that the young man was industrious, he put him in charge of all the forced labor of the house of Joseph. Verse 29, it came about at that time when Jeroboam left Jerusalem that the prophet Ahijah, the Shunammite, met him on the road. Now Ahijah had covered himself with a new cloak, and the two of them were alone in the field. And then Ahijah took hold of the new cloak, which he was wearing, and tore it into 12 pieces. How many tribes were there?
12.
There are 12 tribes, and here you got a prophet about to tear his robe into 12 pieces. He said to Jeroboam, take 10 pieces for yourself, for thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, behold, I am going to tear the kingdom from the hand of Solomon and give you 10 tribes. But he and his descendants shall have one tribe. Benjamin was annexed to Judah for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem, the city which I have chosen out of all of the tribes of Israel. Verse 33, because they have abandoned me and have worshipped Asherah, the goddess of the Sidonians, Chemosh, the god of the Moabites, and Milcom, the god of the sons of Ammon. And they have not walked in my ways and followed my commandments, doing what is right in my sight and keeping my statutes and my ordinances as did his father David. Verse 34, however, I will not take the entire kingdom out of his hand, but I will make him ruler all the days of his life for the sake of my servant David, whom I chose because he kept my commandments and my statutes. Verse 35, but I will take the kingdom out of his son's hand and give it to you, 10 tribes. Yet to his son I will give one tribe, so that my servant David may have a lamp always before me in Jerusalem, the city where I have chosen to put my name and presence. Did you all hear that? Jerusalem, where he will put his name, God's name, and his presence. Jerusalem is called the city of God. Right? What city are we headed for? The New Jerusalem. Because the New Jerusalem is the capital city of the new heaven and the new earth. Oh my goodness. I will take you, Jeroboam, and you shall reign over whatever your soul desires, and you shall be king over Israel, the 10 northern tribes. Verse 38. Then it shall be that if you listen to all that I command you and walk in my ways and do what is right in my sight, keeping and observing my statutes and my commandments, as my servant David did, then I will be with you and build you an enduring house as I built for David, and I will give Israel to you. And in this way I will afflict the descendants of David for this their sin, but not forever. Verse 40. So Solomon attempted to kill Jeroboam. In other words, Jeroboam had become an adversary of Solomon. He tried to off him. But he couldn't. You know why? Because God raised Jeroboam up to be a thorn in the side of Solomon. But Jeroboam set out and escaped to Egypt, to Shishak, king of Egypt, and stayed in Egypt until Solomon died. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? Because Jesus, when he was little, the angel told his mother and father to take him to Egypt. And Jesus is going to stay in Egypt until Herod dies. And when Herod dies, they bring Jesus back to Jerusalem, or back to Bethlehem, Nazareth, right? So, verse 41, the rest of the acts of Solomon and all that he did and his wisdom, are they not written in the book of the acts of Solomon? The time of Solomon's reign in Jerusalem over all Israel was 40 years. He had a long reign. Verse 43, and Solomon slept in death with his fathers and was buried in the city of his father David. Rehoboam, his son, reigned in his place. So now you're about to see the divided kingdom. And the rest of the Old Testament is going to be talking about two different kingdoms, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. Okay? And the northern kingdom will be ruled initially under Jeroboam the first. And here's what you're going to hear about Jeroboam the first. From now on, you're going to be hearing about the sins of Jeroboam. Because Jeroboam is not going to walk in God's ways, but he's going to walk after idolatry and lead Israel, 10 tribes, into idolatry. And so they're going to erect all kind of gods. All right? Rehoboam is going to be over one tribe, the tribe of Judah, and half of the tribe of Benjamin. And watch this. God's word is so true that Jesus will come from the tribe of Judah, which stayed true to the Davidic lineage. God will prevail. His word will prevail. And one of the reasons why, and I tell people, if you want to go to sleep, if you have insomnia, if you have trouble sleeping, all you got to do is turn to Matthew chapter 1 and just start reading at verse 1. And by the time you get through all them begats, you'll be asleep. Okay? But there's a reason why those begats are in chapter 1 of Matthew. Because God wants you to see that the Davidic lineage is still intact because Jesus comes through the line of the Davidic kingdom. And you can trace Jesus' lineage to David through Mary and Joseph because they are both in the line of David. And so Jesus will be the rightful ruler of the throne, and his kingdom will have no end. Questions, comments about anything that we've read or talked about tonight? And I know people, you know, some people don't like history, but history is important. If you don't know history, you are doomed to repeat the failures of the past. And one thing I will tell you contemporarily is this ought to be a lesson. Don't walk away from God. And don't allow things to take you away from God. Because sometimes, through your best efforts trying to get back, God will erect some things to whip you because of your disobedience. And when God get on you, ain't nothing gonna stop him but himself. So you don't want to be on God's bad side. Trust me, you do not want God as an adversary. Questions, comments? A whole bunch of talking going on. Yep. Grab that mic behind you.
Pastor, one of the things that I see in this that we need to learn is that there are, if we're not careful, generational curses can perpetuate. And again, this book that I'm reading, almost finished with it, Dr. Tony Evans deals with U-turns. Mm-hmm. And there's a section in there stating the things that we need to do to stop generational curses. Now, I'm also a believer in generational blessings. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's the opposite of, in many cases, what we're reading here tonight. Right. So I think we need to be mindful of those things as it relates to both. So, mm-hmm. you know, I don't know if you had anything else to add in reference to those components.
Well, I'm glad that you made that point, because it's a very important point. That whereas, you know, if you turn away from God, there are generational curses. You know, here, think about this, that some people are devastated because of their environment. Let's say you grew up in a house where, you know, your dad is a drunk, or he's running the streets and depriving the family of what they need. Mother is strung out on drugs. You know, a lot of times we have to come through a lot of stuff in order to really see the Lord and to come into favor with the Lord. And, you know, listen, nobody comes through a perfect environment. We all got to go through something. But it is something to be said for people who grow up in an atmosphere that is godly, because they have less things that they have to unpack, or that God has unpacked for them, and they can live a life of joy and happiness if they follow the Lord and if they, you know, walk in His ways. And we need to be thankful, you know, that God has blessed us through all of the stuff we've had to come through. You know, because if it hadn't been for the Lord, I don't know how I would have made it. You know, and that ought to be all of our testimony, because we've all come through stuff. And all of it ain't been good. You know, the old warriors say we come up through danger seen and unseen. Well, see, you know, those kind of sayings you don't understand unless you live. And I understand unseen dangers, because God has shielded me from a whole bunch of stuff that could have overtaken me. And God will do that. I thank God for grace and mercy, right? Grace for God giving to me what I do not deserve, and mercy, God withholding from me what I do deserve. And God will do the same thing for you. And it doesn't matter how you start, it does matter how you finish, right? None of us picked the family that we were born in, right? We didn't pick our moms and dads. And so we were dealt a hand, we had to play it. But all of us have the opportunity to turn away from evil and turn to God. And it's the best decision anybody can make. So that's very good. And then when you start to live and start a legacy of walking with the Lord, you set your kids up for the same thing. Because now all of a sudden, because of the way you teach, the way you walk, they start to see the blessings of walking with the Lord. And they start emulating what they see in you. And they are blessed. And then, you know, people that grew up in the South, they understand this very well. Sometimes, you know, favor will come your way, not because of you, but because of your mom and daddy. Folk will tell you, they'll tell you, I'm going to do this for you because of your daddy, because your daddy was, you know, a certain way, or your mother was a certain way. They were true to their word, and you look like you come from good stock. I'm going to take a chance on you. And they would give you favor till you messed up, you know, and then, you can mess up a good name, right? And so parents today, if they doing what they're supposed to be doing, they'll tell their kids, don't, I've given you something that's very important. You got your name. And don't go out here messing up our name. Hello, somebody. Amen. That's very important. That's why you shouldn't name your kids just anything. Name them something that they have to live up to. Praise God. Well, you know, I did some research on my name. And the name Gary, I think I got it from Gary Cooper, the actor. I think that's how my mother named me after. But the name Gary means mighty warrior. I said, that sounds pretty good. Right? I like that. And then my son, Isaiah, my youngest son, before he got married, and I did his marriage ceremony along with somebody else. Before we did it, he gave me this coin. And I carry this coin in my pocket every day, and I will for the rest of my life. And on this coin, there is a warrior and all of the armor that a warrior is supposed to have is on this coin. The helmet of salvation, the shield of faith, the belt of righteousness, sandals shod with the gospel of peace, breastplate of righteousness, all of them are on this coin. And when he gave it to me, and you know, we're about to go into ceremony, I said, you trying to make your dad tear up, ain't you? It ain't gonna happen. Well, it did happen. I had to gather myself. Because whereas it may just seem like a coin to others, this means so much to me. And then he told me that in the military, soldiers have a coin that they carry with them everywhere they go. And I said, okay. So I keep it in my pocket. That's my coin. Right? Warriors. We are warriors. We are Christian soldiers in the army of the Lord. And we need to, if people accuse you of being a Christian, you ought to be guilty as charged. Anybody else got anything? Everybody satisfied? Praise God. So next week, who's got their schedule out? I believe next week we're going to be studying the book of Esther. Is that right? What is this? This is the 18th. So 7 days will be the 25th. August 25th. Have you got you? Let's see. August 25th. Yep. So we'll be chapter 1. 1 and 2 of Esther. So make sure you read Esther chapter 1 and 2, and I will tell you, if you don't know this, I will tell you this. The book of Esther is the only book in the Bible where God's name is not mentioned. But God is orchestrating the events behind the scenes. So if anybody ever asks you, what book of the Bible is God's name not mentioned, it is the book of Esther. Okay? Prayer requests. Anybody got a prayer request that they want us to? And we certainly, I know the kids, you know, here started school. We need to cover these kids. Not only here, but we need to cover kids all over, because I understand that some schools in the South have started. They're two, like 3 weeks in. Some of them have already had to cancel classes. Because of the spread of the virus. You know, at one time they didn't think that it affected young people. And now they're finding out that this new strand don't care how old you are. Right? And so we need to cover faculty, staff, students, janitors, everybody that's involved in the school system. Because everybody's important. Even in the janitorial staff, they are important. We don't want anybody being affected or infected. Anybody else got a prayer request? Yeah, Tomir. Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Yep. Yep. All of that. A lot. Debbie?
Pray for Michelle Daly, one of our members. She has surgery today. They thought they were going to release her this today, but Devon said they're going to keep her overnight.
Okay. All right. Anybody else? All righty. Well, Tomir, why don't you dismiss us in prayer? Just hold all those prayer requests up before the Lord and ask God's blessings.
May we bow our heads. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth.
Thank you, Lord.
Father God, we now come to the end of another enriching Bible study. Father God, we thank you for the resident theologian that you've placed in this part of your vineyard. Amen. Continue to anoint him with wisdom and knowledge,
Jesus,
to teach your word in a manner that all of us from the oldest to the youngest can understand.
Mm.
Father God, we're holding up those folks in Haiti.
Yes, God.
Dealing with an earthquake, and on top of that, all those folks that are in the path of all of these hurricanes. Mm. We know it's hurricane season, but
Jesus.
God, you are able.
Yes.
Father God, those folks even in this country, they're on the path of the hurricanes. We ask that you bless them as well.
Yes, God.
Sure. Father God, for this worldwide pandemic, and for those that are politicizing this thing, even them, we ask that you hold them in the hollow of your hand.
Mm.
We ask for a spirit of cooperation.
Yes, yes.
That all mankind will know that they were created by thee.
Mm-hmm.
And those things that the enemy tries to use to divide us, help us to see it for what it really is.
Yes.
And help us all, as men, women, boys, and girls, to turn to thee.
Mm.
Because if we all turn to you to know what we have in common in Christ Jesus, I believe you will subside this and heal the land and heal everyone that is in the path of this pandemic. For those folks in Afghanistan, I know many of them might not be Christians, but just to see again a civil war and the magnitude of folks trying to get out and want to cling to a plane and then subsequently fall to their death, and senseless shootings and killings of innocent women and children, and just making certain parts of their women feel less than. Again, Father God, we ask that you intercede. Father God, we ask for a special blessing upon Michelle. Just saw her the other night with her family. Father God, you are a God that healeth. You are the great physician. We ask that you touch her body, touch her family, keep them all safe from hurt, harm, and danger. We ask that you bless everybody here tonight. We ask all a special blessing upon all the children that went back to school or who have already been back in the school. We just ask that you put a hedge of protection around them. We know that you are the God that when the enemy raises up, that you are able to raise up an even higher standard. And you are able to hold him at bay.
Jesus.
We ask that you keep the doctors and the nurses and anyone associated from the healthcare industry, keep them from hurt, harm, and danger so that they can take care of those that are suffering.
Yes.
We ask for other parts of the educational system, regardless of what the position might be. We ask that you keep all of them from hurt, harm, and danger. Father God, help us to realize that as a people, if we would just turn from our evil ways, you said in your word that you would heal our land. You would heal the people. What a time to turn to you at such a time as this, as we get ready to learn about Esther. And learn that there is providence that can move us to purpose. We thank you, God.
Yes.
We praise you, and we ask that as we leave this place, but never thy presence, mm-hmm. that you afford us safe passage home.
Yes, God.
Travel in grace.
Yes.
And again, we'll be so careful to give you all honor, praise, and glory, because you are a dynamic, yes, and righteous, yes, and holy God.
Yes.
It's in your darling son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God bless you, and join us again next Wednesday for another study of God's word. We love you, and we're praying for you. God bless.